On the title, Use of Live Probiotic Organisms Associated with Pre- and Postbiotics in Stimulating the Immune System of Pets, Dog and Cat and Chicken.
Dear colleague, good morning. Today I am present my presentation regarding the use of live probiotic organisms associated with pre and postbiotic in stimulation the immune system in pet. And in particular, I present my experience in dog and cat and chicken, and some experience also in men to represent my concept and this story. So, the introduction of my presentation regarding the cross-talking between microbiota and host intestinal mucosa, and in particular the very important point is the communication between the world above and the world below that is present inside the GI tract. We have that the communication of bacteria that constitute microbiota with the intestinal barrier is represented by three types of signal: biochemical signals, immunological signal, and metabolic signal. And today we start to speak about the biochemical signal that are represented by PERMS, PLR system, that is very important to permit the cross-talking between bacteria and enterocyte. This cross-talking is very evident, is very important because they act also a communication for mitochondria that are present inside enterocyte, and is very important organelle mitochondria that is involved in the healthy or tight junctional system that assure the normal integrity of intestinal barrier. So, the system of communication between the world above and the world below is represented by the delivery performed by microbiota of PAMs, pathogenic associated molecular pattern, that are evaluated and are associated with the pattern recognition receptor that are present in intestinal cells. The delivery of PAMs is associated with the association and the cross-talking between PAMs and PRRS. And when we have a condition of eubiosis and the PAMs are correct, we have a correct communication between these two parts of the story with a very good healthy status of intestinal barrier in the GIA tract. This system of cross communication between microbiota and intestinal cells is at the basis of innate immunity and the system of normal recognition of antigens. So, in this very simple scheme, we have the two normal conditions that are present in intestinal wall. When we have a condition of eubiosis represented by good percentage of Firmicutes, Faecalibacterium prausnitzis and Lactobacilli, we have a delivery, a very good melange of PAMs that are able to stimulate in a very correct manner the PRRS receptor over intestinal cells, and this contributed to a normal maintenance of oral tolerance and a very good signal that are also transmitted in the submucosa for immunitary cells. In condition of dysbiosis, in which we have the prevalence of proteobacteria and in particular Enterobacteriaceae, with a very decrease of probiotic, we have a not good signals or bad signals represented by PAMs that are able to activate it, in particular dendritic cell and inflammatory cells, and to promote the alteration in the normal permeability of intestinal barrier with inflammation for which concern the intestinal wall. The very important element that act the communication between the world above and the world below are represented by toll-like receptors. Toll-like receptors are glycoproteins that are present over the surface of enterocyte, but are present also inside enterocyte in the microsomal system. And in particular, in the last year, we have seen that toll-like receptors are present also over the surface of mitochondria inside enterocyte. We have 11 types of toll-like receptors that are different because they react with different subset of antigens or PAMPs. And a very important type of toll-like receptor is toll-like receptor 4 that is able to react with LPS belonging from gram-negative bacteria, endocannabinoid, opioids, and the other antigens that are derived, for example, during dysbiotic condition or during EBD. So this is a normal disposition of toll-like receptor over the surface or the membrane of the enterocyte and inside the cytosol in the microsomal fraction. It's very evident that the parasite, yes, bacteria or DNA, RNA belonging or delivered from bacteria are able to excitate and to light different type of toll-like receptor. When we have the delivery of antigens, the activation of the system is very simple. It is the basis of the non-specific response. In this slide, we have the arrival of PAMPs that are associated with toll-like receptor, and by this crosstalk and by this cross-linking of PAMPs with toll-like receptor, we have an effective response of the intestinal barrier. It's very interesting to note that some cells as mast cells or mastocytes that are present in the lamina propria show different toll-like receptor over the cellular surface. When toll-like receptor of the mast cells react or cross-link with the PAMPs, we have a partial degranulation of mast cells that are able to communicate with neurons that are present in the submucosa. And this is the first step of the good brain axis communication that is able to communicate also of the nervous central system, the presence of a dysbiotic condition and a not good condition in the gastrointestinal tract. The cross-linking of PAMPs with toll-like receptor is only the first part of the story. When we have the activation of toll-like receptor generate a secondary signal that is able to activate intracellular sensor that are represented by the NOD system. NOD 1 and NOD 2 represent cytoplasmic receptor composed of three different domains that are able to react with different antigens belonging or delivered from gram-negative bacteria, from viruses, from fungi, or gram-positive bacteria. The mechanism of transmigration of the signal from two membrane surface of enterocyte, cytoplasmic and the nucleus, is very well represented by this very simple mechanism. So, we have two different bacteria that deliver PAMPs that are able to react with toll-like receptor over the surface of the enterocyte membrane. This cross-activation induced a secondary signal that is able to activate NOD1 and NOD2 receptor and to induce a microsomal damage. This microsomal damage is interpreted by the enterocyte cells with a activation of IKK system that is a particular system present in the cytoplasm of enterocyte. The activation of this system interacts with nuclear factor Kb complex. Nuclear factor Kb complex is a complex present in an activated form in the cytoplasm of not activated enterocyte, in which we have that the active part of the molecule represented by these two subcomponents of 50 and 65 kilodalton protein is associated with IKB complex. When we have the EKK activation, the EKK is capable to hydrolyze this NFFKB complex to degrade the system and to deliver the active part of this molecule represented by the two subset and two submolecules of 15 and 65 kilodalton molecules that at this point is able to pass across the nucleus pore to lie different area of DNA, in particular the intronic area of DNA, and to activate the transcription of some area of DNA, in particular some genic loci that are able to increase the transcription and the production of some molecule as TNF-alpha, IL-6, IL-8, that are able to pass in the cytoplasm and around the enterocyte and activate the COX-2 system that are able to increase the inflammatory status of the mucosa. These multi-step pathways indicate that PAMPs are the first step of the story that bimin, toll-like receptor, and NOD system activation are able to activate the genetic transcription and to activate the direct production of some interleukin packaging that is able to induce a night phlogotic or inflammatory signals to the cell and to the mucosa. In this panorama, mitochondria are very important actors. Actually, the big question is why the mitochondria are able to interact and to cross-talk with bacteria. The answer is very important, and a very important article that clarify the mechanism of cross-talking between mitochondria and bacteria of the GI tract is represented by this very important article published in Science in 2014, in which the authors demonstrated that mitochondria are very old bacteria that in the archaic period are metallotrophic bacteria or very very old bacteria that maintain some receptor that are able to catch some signals belonging from the microbiota that is present inside the GI tract. The mitochondria show in the surface toll-like receptor that are able to lie PAMPs delivered from microbiota inside the intestinal tract, and they modulate the ATP production depending on different signal belonging from the bacteria environmental that are present inside the lumen of the GI tract. The mechanism is simplified in this slide. This is a normal condition in which we have some mitochondria inside the enterocyte. The mitochondria show toll-like receptor over the surface of mitochondrial membrane. And in normal condition of eubiosis, mitochondria produce high quantity of ATP that is fundamental for maintaining the correct action of tight junctional complexes. When a dysbiotic condition is present and we have an increase in pumps delivery inside intestinal lumen, pumps are able to pass inside the cells to lie toll-like receptor 4 that are over the surface or the membrane of mitochondria and to induce destruction of some mitochondria, increase the intrinsic pathway of apoptosis. The death of mitochondria reduces dramatically the ATP production inside the cells, and this may have a very bad effect on the tight junctional complex because the absence of ATP is able to induce a breakdown between the tight junctional complex and the opening status of the tight junctional complexes, with increases of some pore and increase the paracellular passage of some antigens as food allergens or bacteria wall body or bacteria toxin between two different enterocytes. In this condition, we have another very important things. We have the delivery or zonular adherence or ZO1 antigens that is detached from and pass free inside the lumen or increase eye concentration in the fecal material or pass in the bloodstream, and we have an increase in zonulin antigens in the bloodstream and in the sera of patients that show a high degree of tight junctional breakdown during EBD or, for example, celiac status or Crohn's disease or the other intestinal pathology that are associated with high dysbiotic consideration. When we have the opening of tight junctional, we pass from a normal tight junctional status a condition, pathological condition, so-called leaky gut. Leaky gut condition is very important because the opening status of tight junctional between the enterocyte is able to make a passage of different pathogens, for example, food allergens, bacteria LPS, bacterial product, or wall bacteria bodies that are able to pass across the epithelial layer and to react the bloodstream and to go around the body and to perform a very high inflammatory effect for the entire body. When we have a normal tight junctional complexes and the good barrier is normal, we have that pathogens are blocked and we have the passage only a very little portion of antigens that normally are not capable to recall inflammatory cells. In this condition, we have high presence and high secretion of IL-10 and TGF-beta that are two different interleukins related with recall of TH3 and Treg lymphocytes that are able to maintain the oral tolerance to different antigens. And the opposite, when we have the leaky gut condition, we have the passage of different allergens and antigens across the alterated membrane and a good barrier, and we have the stimulation of dendritic cell with very high activation of neutrophils, macrophage, with a production a subset of interleukins and interleukin 17, interleukin 1, 6, 12, TNF-alpha, interferon gamma that are able to increase the inflammatory status of the intestinal wall. In this status, we have the difference between an oral tolerance situation versus an EBD situation. The leaky gut condition is a very first step of the story because when we have an alteration in the normal permeability of the gut barrier, we have the nutrient malabsorption, immune response alteration, multiple food intolerances, autoimmune disease, and this is very vicious circle. This vicious circle is very important because it's possible in this condition the cross passage across the intestinal barrier or some antigens that perform a very bad communication for which concern the gut brain axis, the gut liver axis, the gut lung axis, and also the gut skin axis, with it presence or the appearance of some pathology as liver disease, for example, lung allergies, skin sensitization, or in some cases, brain degeneration, as observed, for example, in different animal models or in patients in which a gut brain axis alteration may be associated with Parkinson's disease or Alzheimer's disease. In this scenario, probiotic, prebiotic, and postbiotic are very, very important and useful arms that act very useful manner, and they represent a very important alternative to antibiotic or anti-inflammatory drug therapy. Probiotic, prebiotic, and postbiotic act in a different manner and in a different way, but they cooperated in attempt to recall in a normal status the gastrointestinal tract barrier. In particular, a very important and very important consideration are related to differences between probiotic and postbiotic. The differences of the two type of product is that the probiotic are live bacteria that are able to produce some metabolite as short chain fatty acid that shown a very good effect in terms of energy and in terms of good maintenance of the integrity in the intestinal barrier. And they are active for short time to colonize the gastroenteric tract. Postbiotic belonging from probiotic after treatment, for example, by pasteurization or irradiation, and they present sole part of probiotic, for example, exopolysaccharide, enzymes, cell wall fragments, bacterial isates, cell-free supernatant, or various other metabolites, but postbiotic are the fragment or the not live bacteria that are able to maintain some important activity in the GI tract. So, after this important introduction, I testimonied my personal experience in the effect of probiotic and postbiotic in the, to reconstruct the normal. The first model is the dog with EBD, and in the first study we demonstrate the comparison of microbiological, histological, immunomodulatory property or of probiotic in a dog with EBD. So the study is that considered 20 dogs with a diagnosis of EBD. The animals were subdivided in two groups, each group of 10 dogs that received one group, a classical therapy represented by metronidazole and prednisone, and 10 dogs that represented the study group in which we have used a particular probiotic blend, SLAB 51, that is represented by 450 billion lyophilized bacteria that were subministered or administered in the dog for 16 days. The evaluation performed in this study were a clinical activity index, histology score, citrullinemia, immunology and microbiota composition before and after the two different treatments and in comparison with a control interacted group of dogs. The result demonstrated a very interesting element, for example, for what concern histological score. It's very evident that in this graph, the probiotic treated dog before and after treatment don't show a very good result as we have obtained, for example, in dog treated with a classical therapy, prednisone and metronidazole. But this is an expected result because we have only probiotic treatment without any anti-inflammatory treatment. In this two group, A very interesting result is performed when we observe the level of TGF-beta and FOXP3 expression by lymphocytes that infiltrate in intestinal mucosa of probiotic-treated dog to respect control or classical therapy dog. In classical therapy dog treated with antibiotic and prednisone, we have that exam of TGF-beta expression before and after therapy don't show any differences, as the same result were obtained also for FOXP3 subset of CD3 lymphocyte. Very interesting, we have that in the group of dog treated with probiotic, we have a very increase in TGF-beta and in FOXP3 positive CD3 lymphocyte after 16 days of probiotic therapy. This demonstrated that probiotic therapy is capable to modulate the composition of inflammatory cells in the intestinal submucosa of treated probiotic treated dog in attempt to increase the typical interleukins that are able to increase the oral tolerance and to decrease the IBD status or inflammatory status in the intestinal mucosa. The SIBDI result demonstrated that for a clinical point of view, the results are very similar in probiotic or classical therapy treated dog. When we concern the histological aspect of infiltration in intestinal mucosa, it's very evident that when we observe the CD3 infiltration of a dog treated with probiotic before and after the treatment, the number of CD3 lymphocytes is view, we don't have a very important differences after treatment with probiotic. But when we observe the subset composition of these lymphocyte, it's very interesting to note that a dramatic increase in the subpopulation of CD25 FOXP3 positive lymphocyte or tolerance or tolerogenic lymphocyte is increased after a period of 16 days of probiotic therapy in dog treated with probiotic. Similar results were observed also when we observed the TGF-beta expression. It's very evident before and after the probiotic treatment a very dramatic increase in the cell positive for TGF-beta expression, also in enterocyte, lining cell, and in inflammatory cells that are present in the lamina propria of a biopsy sample belonging from dog. For what concern the status of molecular that represent the tight junctional complexes, we have the trend of expression in E-cadherin, occludin, and claudin in small intestine and in large intestine. It's very interesting to note that a very similar pattern of occludin and claudin 2 is present in only a probiotic treated dog to respect a control healthy dog, but in dog we have the occludin and the claudin 2 trend expression is very different. The result and claudin 2 expression indicate clearly that probiotic administration restoring the normal expression of protein that composes the junctional complex in dog with IBD to respect the classical treatment that don't show any sign or healing or modification in alterated pattern of occludin and claudin 2 expression in IBD affected dog. This is the aspect in immunohistochemistry of expression in tight junctional complexes in dog treated with metronidazole and steroid or SLAB 51 probiotic or control, it's very evident that for which concern occludin and claudin, the similar trend of expression in control healthy dog and in probiotic treated dog is very in dog treated with classical treatment, metronidazole and corticosteroid. Finally, when we observe the microbiota composition in the intestinal bacterial population of dog with EBD before and after treatment with probiotic or with classical therapy, it's very evident to see that only in the group of dog treated with probiotic we have an increase of lactobacilli, in streptococci, in turicibacter, and a very statistically significant increase in Fecalibacterium composition. Fecalibacterium prausnitzii is a bacterium that make a very important part of normally core of the probiotic population in the microbiome of the healthy dog. And in these cases, we have a very increase in Fecalibacterium only in the dog of the group treated with probiotic, but not in the control group treated with normal classical therapy with antibiotic and steroid. It's very evident that in the classical therapy group, we don't have any differences between and after treatment for reconcern lactobacilli, streptococci, position, and we have no differences, statistically difference for we concern Fecalibacterium composition. The conclusion of this first study demonstrates that the EBD show a very improvement in the group of treatment with corticosteroid and antibiotic, as well as in dog treated with probiotic. But by the point of view of microbiota composition and immunomorphology, and also in the composition of the tight junctional protein complexes, we have that only in the dog treated with probiotic we have a very increase in a aspect, in a trend very similar to normally healthy dog, and on the contrary in the dog treated with a normal or classical therapy with probiotic and steroid, we don't have any signs of improvement in the intestinal barrier with very severe differences between expression of tight junctional protein or molecules between the classical treatment and the normally healthy control group of dog. Another important study is performed in chickens. In the second study, we perform a treatment in the chickens in attempt to observe if probiotic integration in the alimentary protocol of chick is able to increase the productivity of chickens without any antibiotic addition. And we have some evidences by the probiotic effect in terms of grow performances, control of coccidiosis, and control of enteritis in treated chickens. In particular, the material method of this study, we have used 300 Lohmann chicks, male, that were subdivided in two groups, each group constant of or constituted by 150 chick, group P, used as group of treatment of probiotic, and group C, in which we have only the administration of placebo. For each group, we have a different treatment. Group P receive in water of drink 7.5 billion of bacteria per 15 grams of body weight per chick per day. And in group C, we have only maltose without bacteria administered in the drink water. We have that the animal were maintained for a period of 4 months. The chicken were weighed daily. We have selected randomly 15 chicken per group per day, and they are weighed. A chicken were infected 1 month before slaughtered with 3 × 10^5 spoliate or cystococcidia, and attempt to observe it also if probiotic administration show any effect in terms of coccidia colonization and coccidia lesion induced in intestinal mucosa. At the end of the study of 4 months after the treatment of probiotic, chicken were humanely suppressed by CO2 treatment, organ removed, weighed, fixed in 10% buffered formalin and used for histologic study. And the sample of litter and feces were sampled in attempt to make the total count of oocysts per gram of feces or per gram of litter by McMaster chamber method, in attempt to evaluate if we have any differences between the control group and the group of probiotic in terms of oocysts concentration. For histology, we evaluated the duodenum, ileum, and cica morphology in attempt to calculate height of the villi, depth of the crypt, duration of villi and crypt, thickness of cica lamina propria, and the lesion coccidial infection score in accordance with Cornwell and McKenzie's study of 2007. This is the very shortly the experimental design with the different time of observation and the time of slaughterhouse and the results. In orange we have the body weight of the chicken treated with the probiotic, and in green the body weight of chicken treated with the control. It's very evident that for all the period of the study, the mean of the body weight of the chicken treated with probiotic is higher than the body weight of the chicken untreated or control chicken. It's very evident that the standard deviation for we concern the body weight of the chicken treated with probiotic is higher to respect the standard deviation of control chicken, and this is a very interesting result that in the future may be considered in the in this study. And we think that this standard deviation is related to some genetic factors or to some particular or individual factor that modulate the response to probiotic administration of the chicken. But in general, the chicken integrated with the probiotic show a very good, good growing performance to respect the other. Photos of the different degree of development and the differences between the group in terms of body weight at 3 weeks, at 5 weeks, and 7 weeks. It's very evident for each time a very big differences between the body weight of the treated with probiotic or untreated chicken when they were compared. Very interesting is the fact that starting from 5 weeks and until the period we have that chicken integrated with probiotic developing in a very early stage secondary sexual element as caruncules with a very red color that are not very well developed in chicken not treated with probiotic. In our opinion, this aspect is very interesting because it indicated that also a possible correlation or a problem by probiotic in hormonal status of chicken that increase or increase increase the development also of the secondary sexual character that are very important for the body maturity and a correct body weight at the time of slaughtering. For what concerns the morphology, we have observed the villosate and crypt depth and also the thickness in the two groups, and we have that the comparison show very We have that a statistical significant differences was observed for what concerns the villi height in the duodenum, but not in the villi height in ileum, in which we don't have any statistical differences, but term of cecal lamina propria development and in particular the area of lymphoid follicles in control to respect in a probiotic integrated chicken is very evident. High expression and development of lymphoid tissue in the cecal lamina propria was observed, and this demonstrated also the concept of a very good modulation performed by probiotic in the disseminated associated with the lymphoid tract. For what concerns the lesion score, a very interesting result were observed in terms of inflammatory cell infiltration in SLAB51 integrated chicken to respect in control chicken with a very high degree of lesion score in control chicken to respect of probiotic treated chicken. And finally, also for what concerns the coccidia colonization, we have a very statistical differences between control to respect SLAB51 integrated chicken, in which the medium number of coccidia oocysts and the oocyst score was statistically different for control chicken. Finally, when we observe the general mortality rate in the two groups, we have a very difference with a dramatic decrease in the percentage of mortality chicken in probiotic integrated chick, in which we have only the 10% to respect 30% of mortality in control group, with a very statistical significant differences between these two parameters. The last study that I present is performed also in chicken, and in this last study we have reached a very new frontiers of probiotic integration by administration novel directly probiotic in attempt to evaluate if it is possible to modulate the microbiome composition in animal during the embryonal period and the effect of this very early modulation of microbiome composition also after the hatchery in the life of the pre-hatchery or in embryonated status integrated animal. For which concern this study, we have evaluated at the end of the study the growth performance, the control of coccidiosis and necrotic enteritis incident in the chicken integrated in ovo with probiotic to respect chicken used as control and inoculated only with saline stable solution. For this study, we have used three groups, H group constituted by 115 embryonate egg belonging from Ross strain of chicken inoculated at 18 days of incubation with the vaccine of Marek disease and with different concentration of probiotic blend. In particular, in the group P1, we have embryonated H embryonate egg with 1 per 10 to the 6 uniform in colony per milliliter of inoculum. In the group P2, we have inoculated uniformly colony per milliliter, and group B3 or control group we have inoculated the egg at 18 days with only saline sterile solution. The inoculation was made in the amniotic cavity because the amnios in the last day of incubation is drinked by the chicken, and probiotic inside the amnion are able to pass directly in the gastrointestinal system, but also in the respiratory system, in the ocular mucosa, in the conjunctiva, and they stimulate the innate response in all the different apparatus of embryo. This is the experimental design. It is very important to note the hatching rate. The hatching rate is not different in the three groups as, in my opinion, in the first time expected. I think at the start of this experiment that the inoculation in the embryonic egg of live bacteria may induce the embryo death. But this is not the true story because, as observed in this slide, we have a very similar pattern of hatching in the three groups, with 97% of hatching in the higher concentrated inoculated egg by probiotic, 100% in the group B2 inoculated with the lower dosage of probiotic, and 98% of hatching in the group C inoculated only with saline sterile solution. All the chicken were not vaccinated for coccidia. The different phases of egg inoculation with probiotic and different phases of breeding of the hatched chicken in different phases of breeding and evaluation daily of each chicken in the three group to evaluate the growth rate in the different performances of the three group. So the results demonstrate a very low rate in the three group. It's very evident to note that in the group P2, inoculated with the lower quantity of probiotic bacteria, we have the better parameter in terms of growth rate in the chicken. When we perform this body weight at 28 days in the 9-5 at the day of suppression of the chicken. It's very evident that the difference between the growth rate and the body weight is observed in the first day after the hatching, at the 7th day after the hatching, and also this difference is maintained, is very, very excited at 28 days after the breeding at T5, in which is very evident the statistical difference between the growth rate and the body weight in the group of control to respect the two group of chicken inoculated. Similar results were obtained also for this concern the morphology of the digestive tract. It's evident that the differences between in the length of the intestinal life for this concern the duodenal tract or the iliac tract was observed in the two inoculated group to the
Grazie.